Hello, everyone, and welcome to tonight's IAI Live on Mind, Maps, and Reality. Be it in the stars, in tea leaves, or in our naming of the botanical world, humans are drawn to finding patterns everywhere. Many of these are hugely valuable. Finding our way about depends, after all, on recognizing patterns. But our attachment to pattern can also limit creativity. And worse, it can encourage tribal thinking, bigotry, witch hunts, and conspiracy theories. Should we break free from our desire for pattern? If we were less attached to our set ways of thinking and more open to new patterns, would we become more creative and more fulfilled? Or is pattern necessary both to our personal lives and society, something without which we would face a chaotic and threatening world? To explore the nature and significance of patterns, we have got three brilliant speakers who I am delighted to present. A cutting-edge psychologist and neuroscientist, Lisa Feldman Barrett, has revolutionized the way we understand emotions, brain-body connections, and human nature. She is a university distinguished professor of psychology at Northeastern University, and she also holds appointments at Harvard Medical School and Massachusetts General Hospital. An expert on perception, knowledge, and intellectual vices, Quassim Cassam has brought his philosophical insight to bear on issues ranging from terrorism to conspiracy theories. He is professor of philosophy at the University of Warwick. Hilary Lawson is a postmodern philosopher and a renowned critic of philosophical realism. He is best known for his work on reflexivity and his theory of closure, which puts forward a non-realist metaphysics, arguing that we close the openness of the world with our thought and language. To begin this debate, I would now like each speaker to give a brief 3-minute presentation of their thoughts on our opening question: should we try to break free from our desire for pattern? Lisa, would you like to start with this?
Thank you. Yes, I would. Thank you. So I think we should start by understanding what a pattern is and where it comes from with an example. Suppose you're listening to a podcast and someone comes on who is introduced as a scientist. What do you know about this particular scientist? Probably not much, but you probably know something about other scientists from personal experience, from movies, from books, television, and so on. And so maybe based on past experience, you know that scientists tend to speak in jargon and drone on and on and on in ways that are particularly hard to understand. And so your brain assembles this knowledge very quickly and uses it to predict what the scientist on the podcast will do next, maybe talk confusingly, and then what you should do next, like listen extra carefully or maybe tune out. These patterns emerge as your brain creates a category called scientist using past experiences. A category is a group of things which are similar to one another in some way. And categories allow your brain to predict what to expect, how category members will act, and what you should do in return. You cannot break free from categories because your brain creates categories instantly, automatically, and continuously throughout your entire life to make sense of the world around you. If your brain could not create categories, it would receive wavelengths of light through your eyes, but you would not see objects. Your brain would receive changes in air pressure from your ears, but you would not hear recognizable sounds. Without categories, you would be experientially blind. There's a bit of jargon for you. So it's not really possible to break free of categories and the patterns they create. But what we can do with a lot of effort is understand to what extent a particular category is in the world, that is in nature, versus in our collective heads. How much are we detecting similarities in the people and objects and other things around us versus how much are we constructing those similarities? So we do not recognize categories and the patterns that they give rise to. Our brains construct them. And most of the categories that we assume to be natural in some way are actually constructed in our collective heads. And it turns out that our very big human brains have a lot of flexibility in the categories that we can create, in the similarities that we can compute, and in the patterns that guide our actions.
Thank you so much, Lisa. What about you, Hilary? What is your pitch in the question, should we try to break free from our desire for pattern?
Well, I have some things to say this along the lines of what Lisa was saying there, but from a more, not surprisingly, philosophical frame. So you mentioned the closure theory when you did your initial introductions, and it's an account of how we make sense of the world. But you could also see it as a theory about the mechanism of forming patterns and how that mechanism works. And I'd be more inclined to use the word, instead of patterns, I'm inclined to use the word closure for reasons which I think might become apparent. So, and I think these closures do impact not only the way that we think, but the way that we perceive reality and enable us to intervene in the world. So what would be an example of that? Well, when you look up at the stars, there's an almost indefinite number of patterns that you could make out of those stars. In the West, we tend to have standard constellations like the Plough or the Big Dipper, as it's known in North America, or Orion, or whatever. But other cultures have different patterns. They have different ones altogether. And that should come as no surprise, because there are more patterns we could make of the night sky and the stars than there are atoms in the known universe, and by many orders of magnitude. So there's potentially, effectively, a limitless number of patterns we can make of those stars. So we can't imagine that any one of them is the true pattern or the correct pattern, but it doesn't mean to say that they're not very powerful. Because once we've identified a pattern and what we now call a constellation, we can use it to point to a star that's nearby. We can track that constellation across the sky. We can fill in the other patterns and use it to navigate the high seas. So patterns don't have to reflect reality in order to be immensely useful. Now, what's going on here with these patterns, since they're not somehow, we're not finding something out there? Indeed, I think it's one of the mistakes of a straightforward empiricism that you can somehow look at the data and get the pattern, when I think that the pattern, the closure, is added to the data. And what I think is going on there is that a pattern is the holding of that which is different as one and the same. So when you look at, say, Orion, you hold all of those different stars as one and the same thing, Orion. And that holding of all of those differences as one thing enables you to somehow make sense of the chaos of the as it were, the input data. And what's more, once you see it as that pattern, you then perceive it like that. You don't just know it to be like that. It changes how you see the stars. As anyone who's got to know what the constellations are, the sky looks different as a result. And the same principle applies, I would argue, to every part of our visual and oral field, all parts of our experience.
How about you, Cassam? What do you think about breaking free and whether that's possible?
Thanks. So I want to take you back to 1997 and the death of Princess Diana in a car crash in Paris. So as many of you will know, a lot of people thought that it wasn't just an accident, that she was the victim of a conspiracy of some kind. Now, that's an example of what I want to call sense making. So by sense making, I mean the attempt to find a deeper meaning in events that would otherwise lack a meaning. So thinking of her death as a product of a conspiracy is an example of investing it with a certain kind of meaning, which it wouldn't otherwise have. Now, sense-making, I think of as an absolutely fundamental human activity, And the search for patterns is a kind of sense making. It's another way of trying to make sense of reality. So to ask the question, should we try to break free from our desire for patterns, is like asking, should we try to break free from sense making? And that's like asking, should we try to break free from being human beings? Right? I mean, the search for the making of sense is what it is to be a human being. So the question, should we try to break free? I mean, that's a non-question, right, to begin with. That's just a non-question. The real question here is among the patterns that we detect, or among the different kinds of meaning with which we invest events, which are real and which are not. So, of course, sense making can sometimes lead us into the realms of fantasy and fiction. So in the case of Diana, right, so that was a classic example where the attempt to invest an accident with deeper meaning led a lot of people astray. So in a case like that, what we have to get used to is the disturbing fact that sometimes shit happens. And that's just a fact about the world, right? Shit happens. But then sometimes it isn't just a case of shit happening. Sometimes it really is a case of something happening because someone planned for it to happen. So another way of putting my point would be to say, you know, the real challenge is to distinguish between cases where we detect patterns that are really there and cases where the patterns we detect are not really there, cases where we invest events with meanings that they, in some sense, have, versus cases in which we are really just fantasizing about what's really going on. So I think that's where the debate needs to be held.
To continue watching this video, click the link in the top left or in the description below, or visit iai.tv for more debates and talks from the world's leading thinkers on today's biggest ideas.